guys, welcome to the video. Really quick before we get started, want to remind you guys that tomorrow will be a double upload here on the channel. So make sure you subscribe, turn on your bell notifications. Also check out my Instagram, clash_with_ash. We're going to have the new season 2 of Clash Royale past details, including the theme and the perks and all that good stuff. And we're also going to have the full list of balance changes for you guys going live around the same time. So of course, stay tuned for that. And without further ado, let's go ahead and jump into a new world record, 8,000 trophies.
School is out and it's sort of a buzz, but back then I didn't really know what it was.
All right, guys, so as you can see on the screen right now, we have Igor, number one in the world, 8,022 trophies. Now, we knew this moment was just a matter of time because of the trophy inflation and the long season. Speaking of long season, just putting it out there, it's my, and maybe I'm biased because I play a little bit more than probably the average player, but I want to get your guys' thoughts on this real quick because I do want to give this feedback to the Supercell team if my subscribers agree with me. But do you guys think there should be more than 35 tiers on the season pass thing? Because I feel like, I don't know about you guys, but it was only a couple weeks or so into the season and I was done, you know? I would like there to be, even if it's not rewards like gold or whatever or chests, maybe just an extra emote like at 50 tiers or 100 tiers. Just give something to incentivize us to continue to play. Are you guys on the same page or am I crazy on that? I might be crazy, I usually am. Anyway, back to the subject of today's video. I was trying to get Igor back on the channel anyway, so this is a perfect time to do so when he set this world record. 8,001 on the Fat Cat account, but there were some allegations of win trading. So what did he do? He went and did it from his main account, Igor. So, well, you can't deny the skill, is certainly. Can you deny how he got there on the first time? Yes, yes, you can. But hey, he got there legit with Igor, so we're going to watch his replays. Of course, Igor, known as, I don't know, one of the best, if not the best, mortar players in the world, certainly on ladder. And we're going to watch his replays that got him to 8,022 trophies today in the video. And just, you know, the reason I love showing this so much, and we'll start with this one here. The reason I love showing this content so much is a deck like this is pretty free-to-play friendly. It's relatively easy to level up, right? Aside from the miner, obviously. And I think this should give a lot of you guys, hopefully, a little bit of motivation that, you know, with enough time and skill, obviously, but enough time kind of crafting and honing that skill, you know, if he can do it, why can't you do it, right? At least that's what I like to tell myself when I'm being delusional. Anyway, here we go into the gameplay, guys. Going against Pekka Bridgeman, the Royal Ghosts version here, to start things off. And I believe this was the match that got him over 8,000 trophies. I'm not 100% sure on that. I have to go check the Stats Royale, the record, the battle log, excuse me. But either way, it was one of these matches that we'll be watching for sure. And I have some good ones in store for you guys. So as we watch, I want to try to pick apart some of the tendencies, some of the habits, some of the tactics and strategy that Igor uses that makes him one of the best players in the world as far as mortar. What allows him to play on this next level? So right out the gate here, you can see using that defensive miner, basically cycling behind his King Tower against a bridge spam deck, and also being rather aggressive with his fireballs. You'll see that throughout all of the replays for the most part here, unless he really needs them in that given matchup. So here we go. It's going to be an offensive mortar played into the battle ram. He supports it with some spear goblins. Zap comes down by the opponent, but we do connect for a couple lucrative mortar hits on that right tower using bats to clean up, and we have miner and cycle. Look at the aggression, guys, being utilized by Igor here, going in with mortar, defending spear goblins, bats, and then right back to the miner on the tower, getting a lot of chip damage here in single elixir time. Well, I guess not a ton, but hey, about 1,000 damage off of that tower, give or take. So now it's going to be one spear hit in the right here. Now it's about 1,000 damage and about 10 seconds remaining here in single elixir time. So here comes another mortar while the Pekka is played in the back. Now check this out. He might try to pull that Pekka, cycle to a miner and pull the Pekka to the back of the tower if he zap retargets. Let's see. I'm not sure if he does it in this replay. Okay, so there's a zap retarget. He's one card away from miner. Let's see if he does it here, guys. Bats. He's just going to go ahead and fireball everything. So he didn't do it in this sequence. Obviously, the timing wasn't perfect, but look at this push. Poison's down as well. We have a bandit, a Pekka, minions, everything coming at us here. We're able to cycle all the way back to Rascals. People don't realize this. I mean, you guys are smart. You realize this. But cycle decks, right? What is, you know, What's the most important thing about a cycle deck, or any deck? Like, this is minor motor cycle, I guess. But the real proof in terms of the indicator of the speed of the deck, right, is the four cheapest cards. It's not the overall deck cost. So when you think about, like, a Golem cycle deck, obviously it's not really a thing. I mean, it could be a thing, but it's not a meta deck. But you could make one if you include four cheap cards, because you can cycle to any of the other cards that you need, and you kind of use those cycle cards as just cards to do chip damage or to defend with or to cycle in the back, and then you're able to get to your important key offensive or defensive cards by cycling, right, via those four cheap cards. So this is, here we do it, guys. We pull that P.E.K.K.A. back, utilizing the miner again, allowing that mortar to lock on to he was still on the P.E.K.K.A.? Was it on the tower? Either way, we did get some incidental damage to the tower there, taking it all the way down to 533 here, about 30 seconds or so into sudden death overtime. Now a high mortar, you'll notice his defensive mortars obviously are going to be placed high, hoping to get more lucrative connections onto the tower, or at least target the support troops coming in that lane, such was the case there. So now we go in with a fireball, we cycle back to the miner, use him defensively. Now look at this push coming in, guys. But guess what? All we need to do is use our fast cycle cards, get back to one more fireball, and it's over, despite the P.E.K.K.A. and the minions and the bandit coming in. And there it is. GG, well played. Look at our towers, guys. They're very healthy. One Royal Ghost, I believe, connection on our left tower. But aside from that, you know, we didn't take much damage, just poison damage. That's it. Let's go ahead and watch the one here against Shadow. This is a good one. This one was really close. It's against a graveyard deck with Skarmy in there. Shadow, of course, an amazing player. I need to get him on the channel, actually, from Nova UK. So check this out, a graveyard with Skarmy, a little bit of Splash Yard in there as well, also some control, the E-Wiz in there. It's a very interesting deck with the bowler, of course, as well. So here it comes, gonna be an E-Wiz and a Baby D on the mortar here. Igor is happy to start out by cycling bats or Goblin Gang in the back. Now, just remember, guys, that Igor does know what all his opponents are playing. It's pretty safe to say. So sometimes when you see his first plays of the game, it might seem like he's being a little bit aggressive. Like, I think last match he started out with Goblin Gang all in the same lane, but he already knew the opponent didn't have like a log in their deck, you know? So just kind of keep that in the back of your mind when you see these starting plays that seem a little bit unorthodox, probably because the pro here on the channel already knows what the deck the opponent is playing. So here we go. We're going to go ahead and switch lanes here to the lane that we already did the damage on, setting up with a mortar, and in response, Shadow has that bowler. So let's see how we play this one. Ice Golem to block the bats. We use bats anyway here. They're going to, let's see, we have one surviving bat going to chip away at that bowler. About 40, 45 seconds left in, and look at this, we send in the miner again, just cycling those miners. He does catch it with the E-Wiz, but, you know, basically forcing a response out of the opponent. Not that we're going to get a lot of damage with that miner, but he's always forcing cards out of the opponent, trying to keep the match playing at his tempo. We talked about this right in our last bait video, and you can see he's doing a good job of that, playing this faster deck out of the two. So here we go. A lot of value he's going to be getting out of these Rascals in all of these matchups. Rascals, I still think, one of the strongest cards in the game. Certainly underrated in terms of their use rates. I think that they should be used more, quite honestly. Anyway, poison comes down. We have Boy Rascal surviving. We're going to go ahead and combo a miner as well. And we play aggressive again here. When the opponent used the big spell and it was at the very end of single elixir time, we went aggressive there. And Ice Golem and Ice Wiz able to stop it. But look at how much minor damage we're able to get on that tower, forcing a Skarmy here out of Shadow. So very well played there on that offensive push by Igor. But this one is not over yet. So check this out. Gonna be a miner again in the back there. Bowler gets one shot against him. It's cool to see Bowler being used again in Splash Yard and Graveyard. You guys know it's one of my favorite cards in the game. But I still think, and I think that you guys are about split 50-50 on this, I still think that the bowler should push back princes, man. A big boulder, it should be able to push back a prince. It can already push back a battle ram, push back a prince too. Anyway, here comes, speaking of the pushback a bowler, here he is targeting the miner there. Fireball comes down as well, but look at this. 650 remaining, 1810 remaining on our tower. 5 seconds left. We go with the offensive slash defensive mortar there in the center. A big response from Shadow, E-Wiz, Baby D, Bowler, all coming in the left lane. We have Rascals set up. Nato comes down. We send in the Miner. He sends in the Skarmy. We use the Fireball there defensively. Smart Fireball. rather than taking, you know, what was to be sure, maybe tower down situation, had all those troops locked onto our tower. So not afraid to use that defensive fireball and prolong this match. So here comes a big graveyard push. We have bats in the back. We have Rascals placed right at the bridge there. We have Spear Goblins placed way towards the King Tower, again, trying to avoid giving too much poison value. Poison still comes down here. We have the Mortar, we have the Goblin Gang, and we have a lot of damage off of our tower. Check it out, guys. 331 remaining on our left tower. Fireball comes down. Miner connects. Igor wins. That was a close, close match there with that final defense pulling through, but only remaining a little bit of damage left on our tower. Let's watch against... what's the most annoying deck in the game right now, guys? Anyone want to say it with me? Lava Clone. Let's watch him against Andrelic here playing Lava... Oh, that's the next... That's tomorrow's video. Shame on me. All right, scroll up a little bit more. Let's watch against Andrelic playing Lava Clone, man. So we are at the top of your screen this time, guys, on the Fat Cat account against Andrelic playing Lava Clone. Man, this is... I feel like no matter what deck I'm running... I do not want to be matched up against Lava Clone. Lava Clone seems OP to me, honestly. It's the highest win rate deck in the game at the time of this recording, at least. And it just, I don't know. I don't know what can be done about it because I personally don't think the Lava Hound needs a nerf. I don't even think the Baby Dragon needs a nerf. I know a lot of you guys do, but I respectfully disagree on that. But Clone in itself doesn't feel OP or needing a nerf. But yet this deck, when you put it all together, right? Oof, it's annoying. It has like a 55% win rate on ladder, which for ladder is unprecedented. For grand challenges, you see 80%, 70% win rate decks all the time. But for ladder, 55 is actually really high. So anyway, here we go, guys. Getting a little bit of chip damage onto the left tower. Meanwhile, he connects, well, remember, we're at the top of your screen. We get chip damage onto his left tower. Yes, or yeah, from our right, his left. Okay, anyway, here we go. Andrelic starts out with a Lava Hound in the back. We respond with a miner onto his tower. So getting some miner chip damage here. Getting the tower down to below 1,000 HP. 888 remaining on that left tower. But we know a big Lava Hound push is going to be coming here in the right. So here comes Lava Hound. Rascals in response. Now I've seen a couple Lava Hound, a Lava Clone replays now from Fat Cat, aka Igor, aka Hazard. Man, choose a name. Choose a name, Igor. And he always does the same thing, right, on defense. He uses his Rascals first, same lane in the back, and then he kind of waits to see what the opponent does. He's not afraid to use fireballs early before the clone comes down if he needs it against the flying machine. So here again, we have mortar set up. We have spear goblins cleaning up those skeletons, and then a snowball comes down, but we do get a mortar connection to the strong side tower here. Now notice, in this match, he actually is using rocket instead of fireball. So I said he's going to be using fireball on defense, obviously not the case in this replay, but he does switch between the rocket version and also the fireball version of this deck. So we know we can finish off that left tower via a rocket. We don't even need it there because bats and miner actually finish off that left tower. But see again how he's been playing a lot of defense through offense in this matchup so far, aggressive with the mortars, especially every time he drops a lava hound, and then supporting the mortars when we can. So here it goes, another mortar connection. Flying Machine is out from the opponent. We go same lane with the Rascals again, recognizing the fact that there's no big spell. If there's any weakness in the Lava Clone deck, it's that there's no big spell in the deck. So here we go again. It's going to be a clone coming down. We get a couple Lava Hounds, a couple Baby Dragons, a couple Flying Machines. And the rocket comes down, but it's not going to be enough. And that's the frustrating thing about Lava Clone, is that it's surprisingly resistant to spells. Aside from poison, of course, but fireball and rocket oftentimes, well, especially rocket, just can't do much against it. And for that reason, the popularity of Lava Clone right now has actually led, in my opinion, to a slight decrease in the use of lightning right now, because lightning's absolutely useless here. I mean, you can use it against a baby dragon and a flying machine, but once they know you have lightning, it's not going to do much against the clone, right? So here we go, a huge push. Luckily, Zap was in hand. Zap takes care of a lot of that madness, the skeletons and whatnot. Bats come down, but again, all these girl rascals and the spirit goblins and everything in hand, well played. Rockets in hand, GG. All we need is one more minor. Actually, we just need the Zap. Zap down, that's it, GG's. Made it look easy there. I kind of, just to show you in double time, guys, I kind of want to show you him play. Then we'll watch the one against Bag. but I really wanted to show you play another Lava. And again, he's on the top here. We'll watch it in double time, but again, this time he's playing the Fireball version against Lava Clone. So let's see how, let's just see the formula that he's using here. Again, look at his starting hand. He starts out with Mortar. Mortar immediately gonna defend, gonna support the Mortar using Spirit Goblin. Spirit Goblin's obviously his card of choice when it comes to supporting his Mortar and defending it. Two Elixir, not too bad, right? And then we can usually bait out a spell out of the opponent at the same time. So now we send in a Miner, staying aggressive here in the right lane, getting a little bit of chip damage. Here comes the first Lava Hound push. I keep wanting to say Lava Loon. Here comes the first Lava Hound push in the left. Baby D in an early clone here by the opponent. Snowball comes down as well. We still have those Girl Rascals. We still have those Spear Goblins, getting a lot of value out of his Spear Goblins in this matchup, both from the Goblin Gang and the Spear Goblins themselves. So again, halfway through the match here, we have Mortar in hand. Let's see what we do. We use it again. So force a Flying Machine out of the opponent. Meanwhile, we get just one hit. Would have really liked two there. But again, we go in with the Miner in back of the tower. He misses that Skarmory Zap, and tower is going to be down. But check out this push. So Lava Hound again. We respond. Same lane, Rascals. Wait for it. Fireball before the clone there. Now comes the clone. And again, can't stop this, right? Normally you want to use your spell after the clone, but if there's a Flying Machine there and you know there's no way for you to get rid of it, you don't have bats in hand, or you've already used your bats, then it's, you know, at that point you know you're going to lose the tower no matter what, right? So here comes a Lava Hound in the right. We go aggressive in the left to stop him from being able to pull off a huge monster Lava Clone push. He's still able to pull off a significant push with a Flying Machine, the Baby Dragon in tow. But again, I mean, I hate having to repeat it, but offense through, or defense through offense, right? Staying aggressive is the key in a lot of these unorthodox matchups, a lot of these difficult matchups, is just forcing them to use Elixir on defense rather than building up a huge push. The same sort of strategy against Golem decks, guys. All right, let's watch one more against Royal Giant here, being played by Bag, who I'm still trying to get back on the channel soon. So we'll watch again in double time here. Obviously, we're back at the bottom of the screen here, going against Royal Giant. So how do you go against RG when you're playing a Mortar Miner deck? Well, we're about to see. So again, being aggressive with the Miner, sending him in first. Back responding with his defensive cards, Mega Minion Ice Wizard. So we go with a defensive Mortar, and we go with the Rascals. Fireball comes raining down, but preventing, I think, only one hit we took from that Royal Giant onto our tower. And we have the chip damage advantage here on his right tower 1 minute into this match. So again, we go ahead and just cycle same lane. Spear Goblins go in with a Miner. We redirect that Ice Wiz. More Spear Goblin value, and they chip away at that Mega Minion. Very well played there by Igor. And now we switch lanes with another Mortar in the opposite lane. Here comes the Royal Giant, and we're going to go ahead and hammer away at that Goblin Cage. A lot of pros' favorite new card, Goblin Cage, right now, right? So we get a lot of chip damage in the right, but check out this Mortar connection in the left. He went with Mortar. We end up getting quite a few hits there. Very interesting play, right, to go with Mortar, trying to force somewhat of a response out of Bag again so he can't pull off like a huge Royal Giant push. So Bag opts to Fireball those Rascals. Meanwhile, we go in, force a Nado out of him, utilizing the bats there, and again, we go in with the Mortar here. So we're going opposite lane against the Royal Giant matchup, and the Goblin Cage, again, disposed of by the Mortar. Bats come down, and we're switching lanes again here, not afraid to keep staying aggressive, and just keep putting pressure with Mortar one lane, Miner the other lane, Mortar one lane, Miner the other lane. This guy's just, he's amazing, and see how aggressive, especially in double time, you can feel the aggression coming out of Igor in this matchup. So again, 1272 remaining on the tower, and man, if I was, nice activation there on the King Tower, but here comes Rocket number one. And I think it might have been too little too late on that King Tower activation. So here come Rascals and the Mortar, offensive Mortar setup. That's gonna be GG. So there it is, guys. That's how you get to 8,022 trophies. Hope you guys enjoyed the replays. A lot of people asking for a Mortar deck to come back here on the channel. I hope you guys were impressed. And hey, good luck if you take this deck into the arena. The deck link, as always here on the channel, will be in the show notes below, along with Igor's player stats and profile, and of course, his Twitter information if you want to go ahead and give him a follow. Guys, thank you so much for watching. A huge shout out to Brent Chong, my YouTube partner. Check out his information as well. Thanks, and as always, take care, guys.